gonna work for Jesus. If you're not ready to go to work for the Lord, if you're not willing to do what God wants you to do, wherever it might be, then Bible study is really not going to help you very much. I'm really teaching. Because the Bible reveals the will of God so you can know the mind of God, so you can do the work of God. You can't read the Bible and not get no timber, not get no lumber. Are you with me here? You got to go up to the mountain and cut some timber. You got a lot to build in life. You got a lot to work on. And the first place you need some timber, some material, is yourself. Go up to the mountain. Cut some spiritual timber. Because you need some work on you. Have I got somebody? But I can think of a whole lot of other places that need work. You need work on your community. You need work on your belief system. You need some work on how to handle your money, because it keeps going out the window and you don't know how to manage it properly. You need some spiritual timber. You need work on your tongue, because out of your mouth coming everything. And let me touch your neighbor and say, there's a whole lot of folk lying in the church. And they lie unconsciously in the church. They need some spiritual timber. Work on your body. You ain't got to be shaking your tail feather all around town. Do I need to go any further? There's a lot of biblical timber that has to be cut. You got to go up in the mountain region and get it. In other words, it's not going to be easy doing God's work. If you're looking for easy, you're on the wrong team, in the wrong line. Spiritual timber is not going to roll down to you. You got to get up and go to work. Too many of us are expecting God to do a miracle. But God is looking for some muscle. I wish I had a witness. The problem with most of us, we're stuck where we are because we keep praying for miracles instead of putting in some muscle in the Lord's work. Too many believers are spectators. They spectate the bulletin, they spectate the choir, they spectate the usher board, they spectate the deacons. You're just a spectator. Then we got them spotlight Christians. When they on program, when they singing in the choir, when their name gonna be called, I wish I had a witness. Then they show up. Have I got somebody? Then we got those self-seekers. If it ain't working for me, don't go my way. You don't do what I say. You don't accept my suggestion. Then I'm not going to be a part. I'm going to take my ball and go home. But God is expecting some holy sweat. I wish I had somebody. Nobody got to call your name. Nobody got to pat you on your back. You working for Jesus, and that's enough. Ain't nobody gonna take my place in line serving for the Lord. God can't be pleased. Look at verse 8. He cannot be pleased with workless believers. God is not pleased with you doing nothing. Get to heaven and tell him I told you. Not pleased. You cannot honor God. Honor God with doing nothing. That's unbiblical. It has no doctrinal emphasis. It's simply incorrect. I'm just going to come to church and go home. God ain't pleased. Pinch yourself again. One more time. Go ahead. because I'm all about through. Look at verses 12, 8, 12, and 13. Haggai gives this message. I'm going to help you out with it. Help you out. If you're struggling, you keep doing the same thing, you're disobedient, you can't get your life together, I'm going to help you out. I'm going to help you right now to become a stalwart soldier for the Lord, where it starts. Amen. Here's the third check. God first. Second, whatever he tells me to do, I'm going to do it. God tells me to study the word of God. Nothing comes before that. That's why nothing should come before Wednesday night. If you're not doing what God said, you're not working for God, you know you got an attitude problem. That's clear. There's nobody that is exempted from that. That's what Haggai is saying. And it's amazing when you look at this third check, which is, there are priorities that promote the work of God. There are what? Priorities that promote the work. If your priorities, listen to me, make it clear. If your priorities are twisted, the consequences of that is your life is going to be twisted. Now, we in this sensitive generation, we don't like to use certain words, but the old folk says if you got perverted priorities, then the next thing is going to happen is you become perverted. Let me help you out. Folk will say it like this. Look, boy, I see you going down the wrong road. Now, what road do they see? They see the priorities of your road. They see where you are sticking your neck out, where you got time to do certain things and you don't have time to do certain things. I see you going down. You gonna come go with me here? I'm just gonna put it out here for you. Your priorities are wrong, then you gonna be wrong after a while. I don't care how innocent it is. Well, you know, I had to work a whole lot of overtime. Overtime gonna get you. You gotta get yourself your priorities right. Are you with me here? Now listen. When Haggai preached this message, it took them less than 1 month, something like 23 days, to start building. They had a few logistics, clean up their harvest. They probably had to purify themselves, confess their sins. But they heard God's word and went right to work. I ain't gonna let you out here without you getting this now. How in the world did they go right to work? Well, when obedience, the Bible just said they obey. When obedience is present in behavior, there are certain consciousness that comes along with your obedience. Everybody lives in a certain consciousness. You may have a negative consciousness. You may have a healthy consciousness. But whatever your consciousness is, you are living in it. It programs your world. Are you with me here? When obedience is conscious, there will be an effective change in attitude and your actions. Which says to us, they had four conscious states of mind, or four conscious states of obedience that are clear in this text. That's all we're going to. Let me give you one. You know why people keep doing what God would have them to do, even though it's rough, even though they got to sacrifice, even though they got to adjust their schedule, even though they got to give a little bit more, they keep doing what God would have them to do. Look at verse 8, because I ain't going to wonder about it. Watch it, the Bible makes sense. You know why? They have a desire to please God. Don't run past it now. They have a desire to please God. You got to ask yourself, some of us are running our own lives. We don't care what the pastor say. We don't care what our spouse say. We don't care what the Bible say. We going to do what we want. Yeah. You know I'm telling the truth. So it don't matter. You when you get up on Sunday, if you feel like coming, if all the stars are properly aligned, if everything rolls out right, you gonna come and show up like you're doing God a favor. He says, if you want to please me, go up to the mountain, cut some wood, and build my house. Why would they do that? Because they wanted to do what? You have to make a conscious decision, apart from your mama, apart from members, apart from folk you don't like in the church, apart from backstabbers, apart from people talking about you, that I myself, Thurman Henry West, want to please God. That's a conscious state of mind. And you may not be living in that consciousness. It's all about you. Are you with me here? Can I give you another conscious state of mind? Look right there in the same verse. He uses this word, you know, folks say, I want to glorify God. Really? There's a desire to honor God. That I will honor God with my life. I will honor God with my money. I'm going to honor God with my mouth. I'm going to honor God with my, as a desire to honor God. You ain't going to get no wood out the mountains. You don't want to honor him? Listen, Christians buy the best for themselves and give whatever is left over to God. Can I help you? That's not honoring God. That's not honoring God. And we do it all the time. We're going to give today, we decide we're going to give God whatever. Whatever. That's how we do God. Because we do each other like that. How do you spell? I'm in the text now. We do whatever in the church. As if we are honoring God. And you're not. You did pinch yourself, did you? And you're not honoring God. How do you spell honoring God? You ready? God comes first. That's the only time he is honored, when he is. I'll catch up when I catch up with you. You ain't honoring God. The people who have a conscious mind to honor God are working for God. You got one of these conscious minds. Can I give you two more? Drop on down to verse 12. The Amplified Bible breaks this word up, reverence. That reverence, that is the verb, they reverently turn. It's how they acted toward God. They reverently turn to the law. The Hebrew is, they reverently turn to God's presence. Because when we're not doing God's will, his presence is exempt in our lives. I ain't got to do nothing, no how. I ain't finna do no how. I'm trying to teach you something. When you're out of the will of God, you have turned away from God's presence. There's anybody I want to walk with in life. There's any company I want in life. It's the Lord. Now, the first thing he said, watch this now. They had a new reverence. You know why? They repented of the fact that I've been treating God any kind of way. Now, if you repent, you have a new reverence for God. Because nobody, listen. Nobody has a reverence for God without repentance. We acknowledge that we've done something wrong. We acknowledge we haven't been right with God. And so we repent, and now we want to do what's. So when you see a reverent believer, it's because they've said, I've been living on the wrong side of the track, and now I want to get it right. Which says today, all of us can say, when I ask you, consider your ways, you can look at your ways and say, God, don't worry about nobody else. don't look at nobody else. It's an opportunity between you and God. To get it right. Are you with me? Finally, they worshiped him. Just real quick, this adverb, worshipfully is the word. Describes their actions toward God. They understood that God is worthy of their lives. He's worthy. He is worthy of my worship. He's worthy of my work. They understood that God should have first place in my life, and as a result, my life will be more valuable. Everything in my life will be more fulfilling if God has first place. If God does not have first place, then everything in my life comes apart and it loses its value. Now you have to believe that, or God will never be first. Getting more money be first, building a bigger business be first. You do all those things and you'll still be empty. Unless you say to yourself today, God, you need to be first in my life, or my life will never be what it ought to be. Now, the Bible says for the believer, it will never be what it ought to be if God is not what? That's what I want you to hear. Number one, listen. You've got to have a desire to please God. And when you please God, God is going to let everything in your life please you. Listen to me, because I ain't got to be long with this one. You have the desire to honor God. When you honor God and lift him high and exalt God, all of a sudden, it seems like everybody wants to be at your beck and call. Favor enters your life. People, you're getting promoted where other folk are not getting promoted. You're getting raised where other folk are not getting raised. Doors are opening for you where doors have not been opened for you. You got credit and you know you had no credit. You got a car and you know you weren't supposed to get it because you gave God the honor and glory in your life. This is making a whole lot of sense to me, but it might not be making any to you. You've got to give God some honor in your life. Then you walk in the door and everybody's looking at you. You wonder why, because you understand you ain't nothing, but you are a child of God. Covered by the blood, and all of a sudden, everybody wants to know what you got to say. Because you honor God, people will honor you. When you place worth on God, God will place worth on you. When you worship God, God adds to your territory. God blesses your life. When you worship him, you decide to say, God, you are worthy of all praise. All of a sudden, God says, you are worthy of everything I got in the storehouse of heaven. What do you need? Because you're worthy of it. I can trust you with it because you'll worship me, you'll praise me, you'll give me glory. You're worthy when you worship God. That's what Job did. That's all Job did. He lost everything. What did he do? He worshiped God. God decided to double his pleasure. When you worship God the right way, he doubles your pleasure. You got to decide. You going to do it your way? Come on now. I'm through. You gonna do it your way? You gonna earn your money? You gonna get your promotion? You gonna go down your highway? Or you gonna do it God's way? Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I told you it was gonna hurt a little bit. But it's the word. For me and you, it's not just for you. It's for me and you. I have to decide in my life. Here's four conscious states of mind. You have to decide. God, I want to please you. Because when you say that, things are going to change in your life. God, I want to honor you. When you say that, things change in your life. God, I reverently turn to your presence. I recognize that I'm just not where I ought to be. I'm looking at this past. I've been looking at it for a while. You know, you have to say, you got to check yourself. God, I worshipfully turn to your presence. When you say that, you know what comes easy? Obedience. Obedience is so hard because our attitude is not right toward God. And your attitude, if your attitude is not right, your actions will never follow. Never. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Just say, Pastor, I want to develop that conscious state of mind. I want to please God. That's it. Let the Holy Spirit help me today develop the conscious state of mind. I want to please God right where you are. You stand with me. I've always said my life, my whole journey, Lord, I'm living to please you. A whole lot of your life gonna change. I'm living to please you. I'm not living to do anything else but please. It's about you. Well, everything else gotta fall in that line. Right there. Come on. Right there. Don't hesitate. God, I want to please you. Develop that conscious state of mind. Come on, don't hesitate. Don't even hesitate. I wouldn't even hesitate. But Lord, I want to please you. Because it changes a lot. God, I want to honor you. Maybe that's you right there. Come on. God, I want to honor you. Come on. Waiting on you. I can't believe I'm waiting on you. Because if you struggle in any area, it's because the first thing that has to develop in you is a consciousness that God, you're to be pleased. You're to be honored. I'm to treat you reverently. I'm to worship you. That conscious state of mind will guide the rest of your life. You go up to the mountain, cut wood, and rebuild his house. That's the real motivation in life. So I'm waiting on you. Come on, real quickly. I don't want to wait long. I'm right here. I'm standing. I want to please God. I won't be anywhere in life. I won't say I want to please God. Because I already know if I don't say that, I'm headed down the wrong road. That road is so easy when you don't want to please God. Come on, help me now. Because I'm trying to let the Holy Spirit deal with you. Come on. Come on, I want to please God. 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 If you want to please God, pray if you ain't standing. Don't look, pray. Pray. You're going to live the rest of your life struggling to be obedient because you have not developed the first conscious state of mind. I want to please you. Listen, I'm really waiting on you. I got to pray because people have already been obedient. God has already dealt with you. You just need to be obedient. It's not between you and the Lord. Nobody else but you and the Lord. I want to be obedient to God. I want to live for him. I want to honor him. Grab somebody by the hand because this is the race we're in. We're living to please God. This is the race we're in. Grab somebody. I'm standing with you. I want to openly witness and say, I'm standing because I want to say, I want to please God. I got no shame about that. I want to please the Lord. The problem, most of y'all are suffering with stress and headache and all kind of problems because you're trying to please other people. I want to please. It's easy to make decisions. It's easy to walk through life when you know what you're trying to do. Come on, I want to pray for you. I want to pray for you. You stand, I want to pray for you. Come on. Father, we go in our closet today. We go in our own personal lives today because we understand that obedience is never within our reach. If within our own heart, our attitude is not right toward you. So, Father, we say in the name of Jesus that you would allow the Holy Spirit to put us on the potter's wheel and allow the Spirit of God to develop in us moment by moment and day by day and morning by morning. We want to please you. We want to do what's pleasing in your eyesight. We recognize that you have called us to work, and Lord, you've called us to work with great effort. Wherever you have called us to work, there will be and always will be opposition. God, we will not get off the battlefield because there is opposition, but we'll press on believing, oh God, that we are in your will and we're doing what pleases you. Father, I pray for those that are standing right now in the name of Jesus that you, God, would so orchestrate in their hearts and minds this one desire that they want to please you, and that priority would direct their lives. That priority would give them a clear vision of what you would have them to do in the name of Jesus. Then I pray for those who say, God, I want to honor you, that because I want to put you first in my life. God, I pray that the power of the Holy Spirit would be available today to make that request so in the name of Jesus. No, God, we turn to you right now in Jesus' name, reverently, because we repent of the fact that we have not placed you first. We've been neglectful. We've been self-absorbed. We've got our eyes on other things. But today, God, we put our eyes back on you in the name of Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all our praise. You're so worthy, oh God. We give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. You may be seated. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, shout amen.
Set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. That every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Yes, it did. I think about the years I spent just passing through, to have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile, take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, stars pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Led me straight to you.